Hi everyone, this is Paulo, and today I'm gonna go over my finals match against Chris Fennell at the TCG Player Invitational. The matchup is Esper Dragons against Red Green Devotion, which is a matchup that you're very likely to see if you play either of those two decks because they're both very common. And I think it was a very interesting match, so I want to go over what I did and why I did the things I did. So the first match begins, first game, pretty uneventfully. We both live with temples, and then I play a Thoughtseize. When I Thoughtseize him, I see Deathmass Raptor, Xenagos, 2 Whisper of Elementals, and 3 lands. So at this point, I think Xenagos is the clear choice, because I don't want to risk him drawing a 2-drop and then playing a turn 3 Xenagos, which is one of the ways I could lose this game. Raptor is not really much of a threat, because it doesn't block dragons and it doesn't kill me fast enough. So, and I have Overtime in my hand already, so I'm pretty sure I can erase his Raptor, so I don't care about it. So yeah, I take Xenagos. The game progresses to a point where, you know, he plays his Raptor, he hasn't drawn anything yet. Next turn he attacks, I take the damage because I don't want to spend Hero's Downfall killing a Raptor. And then he plays an Eldritch Mystic. Now at this point I actually consider playing the Hero's Downfall on his Raptor at the end of the turn because I want a clear board when I play my Ujutai. But I figured that I can still erase anything he plays, and I can Hero's Downfall the Whisperwood and find an answer for a second Whisperwood. So now I know the game is going to be, we're going to be at a point where I'm just going to play my Ujutai, he's going to attack for 3, play Whisperwood, manifest, I'm going to kill Whisperwood, and then I'll be at 12 life because I have a fetch land. So, but with a dragon. So I think that's a pretty good position for me to be in. So I don't want a Hero's Downfall of the Raptor because... So the game progresses to a point where, you know, this is exactly what I was expecting. I attack with my Ujutai, and then I hit 3 lands. But it's important here that one of the lands is a temple, one of the lands is a Dismal Backwater. So most of the time we're going to take the temple there. But Dismal Backwater is actually better in this spot because I'm at exactly 12 life. And the way this game is going to go is I'm going to kill his elemental and counter his next elemental, which will leave him with 6 power in play. So if I'm at 13 life, that gives me a whole extra turn because his deck has no way of dealing direct damage. So Dismal Backwater in this spot is much, much better than Temple of Deceit. So it's very important to recognize this, to be able to see, you know, well, it has 6 damage, I'm at 12, so that's theoretically 2 turns, but with 1 more life, I gain 1 extra turn. At this point, this game is very academic. He is not racing me, and he's definitely not overwhelming me with threats, because I'm drawing 2 cards a turn, I have a dig through time. So he attacks for 6. Yeah, and then I think I can just fast forward here, because this is basically me reacting to everything he does and him dying to my usual die. So here for game 2, I keep what I think is a pretty bad hand, and perhaps I shouldn't have kept. The hand was Disdainful Stroke, Dig Through Time, and 5 lands, among which 2 or 3 temples, but no blue-black temple. So my reasoning was that, you know, I had one answer for his cards, and Disdainful Stroke is one of my best cards on the draw, because it's one of the few ways that I can deal with a turn 3 Xenagos. I also had, you know, a fetch land, and I thought I would just have time to cast my dig, and that proved to be incorrect. Here you can see that I draw, and on my first turn I had the choice between playing a temple or a Dismal Backwater, but I played Dismal Backwater. Even though I drew a land, so I actually really want spells, I think the chance that I might draw Bioblade on turn 2 to kill his mana guy is just more important than playing the temple and scrying one, because scry is going to be good no matter what. So, I think, you know, giving me the chance to Bioblade that guy is more important than... Because I have Disdainful Stroke, so I'm not looking for any specific card on turn 2, other than Bioblade itself, that I can't even cast if I play the temple. So in this spot, it's just better to do that. Here, I Disdainful Stroke his Xenagos, which, you know, prompts a comment from him, that I either don't have Scorn or I have Scorn plus Dragon, which is true. Like, if I had only Scorn and no Dragon, I would have cast Scorn, and so I either have neither or both. Sorry, I could have a Dragon, but if I have Scorn, I definitely have a Dragon to go with it. So there's not much point in trying to play around the Force Spike effect, because I very likely don't have one. I would have to top deck one. At this point, you can see I'm just playing temples and putting cards on the bottom, but my hand is still 5 lands and a dig through time. So I'm in a pretty bad spot here. So yeah, while I'm thinking here, Well, Fennell's thinking, because he took a very long time this match. But yeah, so this is the reasoning. This is the moment he made his comment about not playing around Force Spike, and it was correct to do so because he could have waited to play that Xenagos, but that wouldn't have done much. He can't play around at that point. So yeah, since I'm pretty bad at this game, this is a Crux of Fate, but it doesn't actually help me much this time. So I don't want to cast that. I just want to pass the turn. I hope he commits something more to it, but I'm pretty low already, so I'm probably not winning in this game. Anyway, I think one thing I forgot to mention in the past game is that I already had the counterspell on my hand when I played my Yojutai, and a lot of people would have just passed the turn and tried to control the game. Let's pause here. I died. Okay, a lot of people would just try to control the game, get counter one, or do Esper Rosa, downfall the other, and then play the Yojutai. I think this is not the correct approach. You said I just tapped out turn 5 to play Yojutai and let him resolve Whisper that I knew he had. Because Yojutai just beats everything. So if I have an answer to the Whisper Wood, I don't care if he manifests something. Yojutai is going to draw answers to that. So I think this is a very important point that you have to keep in mind when you play this Esper deck. Is that it is not that much that reactive of a deck. It is a reactive deck, it is a control deck. But you can kill people, and you should. And Yojutai is just, Yojutai is the best card in play almost every time he's in play. And he's gonna beat anything they throw at you. So most of the time I just wanna jam a turn 5 Yojutai if I can. So game 3 starts a bit slowly as proc card to the bottom, and then I think a key point here is turn 2. So turn 2, my hand is I have a Hero's Downfall, a Polluted Delta, and a Caves of Scoreless. So I don't have a counter spell that I want to cast, so I have no incentive to play a Delta and bluff blue mana. Unless I specifically, sorry, play a Delta and have blue mana, unless I want to bluff a counter spell. But if I do that, then the only way for me to cast my Hero's Downfall on turn 3 is by sacking that Delta for Swamp, which could be very bad. And it is what ends up happening. So you see, I think playing the Caves of Scoreless here, the commentator has actually remarked on that, is very important. Because I want to be able to Hero's Downfall on turn 3, but I don't want to have to sack my Delta for black mana. So now I draw Swamp. So that gives me the option of playing Downfall on turn 3 and still keeping a second source of blue mana in my hand. Which I think is very, very important. You have to pay attention to those details. You have to plan ahead and think, oh, how's this my turn 3 gonna go, my turn 4 gonna go? So he plays a Courser. That resolves. It is annoying, but obviously I can't stop it. And I decide not to downfall it because my hand has two Crux of Fates. So if my hand was a bunch of spot removal, I would have just killed it. But since I have two Cruxes, I feel like I'm just gonna get, he's probably just gonna play a Genesis Hydra or something now, and I'm gonna Crux everything away. So I let him draw an extra card effectively by having his forest, and now I can Hero's Downfall the Whisper Wood that he can play and clear the board. Now this is a pretty interesting situation because he's gonna play a Whisper Wood here. So my options are I can downfall it before or after he manifests. So why would I downfall it after he manifests? Because his top card is a Xenagos. So the question is, do I want him drawing a Xenagos? And I decided that no, I don't. Let's pause here for a second. So no, I don't want him to draw the Xenagos because at this point, if I downfall the Whisperwood, I can actually just play a Yojutai. So eventually, I'm gonna attack him instead of Xenagos with the Yojutai, and that's gonna be another card that I draw, another good card. So I think this is a pretty close decision. It's made particularly close by the fact that I don't know that he has red mana if I Crux away that Caryatid. So he could have a mountain in his hand or a Wood of Foothills. It makes sense that he would not have played a Wood of Foothills yet because it has Horsemen in play, and his top has been good every time. So my plan here is I'm gonna kill the Whisperwood. The question is, do I want him to have the Xenagos or not? And I decide that I don't. So after thinking for a while, I let him manifest, I see his next top card, and then I can kill the Whisperwood and play my Yojutai if I want to. So here, this is already an extreme of I've letting him manifest and downfall the Whisperwood. I actually make a mistake here, because at the end of the turn, I thought I was just gonna sacrifice my Delta for an island. So I took one damage from Caves of Scoreless to cast Hero's Downfall, which would be okay, except I already had another Delta in my hand that I knew I was gonna probably get Swamp with. So I should have just gotten the Swamp at the end of the turn and not taking one extra damage. Yeah, now I can play Ozutai and just stop the bleeding, and I know that I have Crux of Fate in my hand still. So there's not much that he can do that is threatening to me because a Planeswalker I can just attack. So Whisper Wood will be the worst card because he manifests something else, and if I Crux everything away, he gets two more manifests, but it's still not that big a deal. So I feel like even though it might look like I'm in a bad spot, I really don't think I am. I really like this spot I'm in this game at this point. Every time you have an Ozutai in play and a Crux of Fate in your hand against Red Green Devotion, it is very hard to lose unless they play Whisperwood. So yeah, I know he has Genesis Hydra in hand. So the worst that can happen is he goes Genesis Hydra into Whisperwood, which will leave him with three manifests in play. But I have two Cruxes. So even then, even if that happens, that is the worst possible, I can just Crux out everything, attack him for five, draw a card, and then take six damage, and next turn Crux everything away again. Oh, I'm sorry, he only had access to six mana, so he couldn't even Genesis Hydra for five there. But it doesn't matter, he could have just played another Whisperwood. So it would have been fine. Here in this spot, he thinks for a very long time. I think actually I should have gotten a warning here. But he's thinking, like, do I want to make a token and throw my Courser away to deal four damage to you in case you have Crux of Fate? Because clearly, if I don't have Crux of Fate, he doesn't want to attack. Right? Because throwing away his Courser for four damage is not worth it. But if I do have Crux of Fate, he wants to attack. But the problem is, perhaps by attacking, he makes it so that I don't even need Crux. I can just play, attack, and he goes and play two removal spells or whatever, and then the board's clear anyway. So I think in the end, he decides not to attack, which I think is the correct decision. I think the four damage is unlikely to matter if I do have Crux, or if I don't have Crux. So just force me to have it, and if I have it, whatever, you miss four damage, that's probably not gonna matter. So correct decision by him. He took a very long time on it, though. Yeah, so I attack, kill Xenagos, and play Crux of Fate. So at this point, it's looking very, very hard for me to lose the game. I don't have a land. I couldn't attack him because I wanted to kill Xenagos, but it's still not a big deal. Like, I know he has Plummet in his deck, but I have another Ojutai in my hand, I think. And I have counter spells. So if I untap this time, it's probably game over. Yeah, I do have another Ojutai in my hand. So yeah, this is the kind of game that you're probably not gonna lose. Here he has to think. He has a Morph that he can play. He has to think, do I want to get rid of this Nissa, which is a great card, so that I can play this Morph? Because I don't have Verbwork in play, so he has to sack that Fetchland to play the Morph. And then he decides to do that. So he searches his library for a mountain, and then plays his Morph. So I love his graveyard. It could be Dim Protector. I know they only have one. It could be a Raptor, it could be a Mist, it could be a Dim Protector, but I think it's still worth it to just kill it. Especially because I can kill it and keep Counterspell mana up. So it's not really a big deal. And I think I have multiple Counterspells at this point. Yeah, I think I have at least two. So nothing bad is going to happen. Yeah, it was a Mystic, but that's not bad either. It just also shrinks his Genesis Hydra that I know he has. Like the Mystic at 2 mana. So I want to Bioblade it regardless of what it is, unless it's exactly Raptor. But I think it's worth Bioblading it. Yeah, here for now is probably thinking whether he wants to draw that Whisperwood or not. He plays a Morph again, and normally I wouldn't counter this Morph, but I have two counter spells and only two blue mana. So the thing that's constraining me in this game is mana and not cards. So with four open mana, there's not much that he can do that is threatening. Like Xenagos is probably his best four mana card, but he would have played that pre-combat if he had it. So at this point, I think I just don't wanna let him have more pressure on me. So it was a bonus that I killed the Dim Protector. But it would have countered almost anything in that spot that didn't leave him with five mana up. Because again, I have more counter spells in my hand, and I can only cast one a turn anyway. So the best way for me to lose this game, not best way, but the most likely way, is if I just get a bunch of answers in my hand and I have time to cast them. Not if I run out of answers, especially if I'm attacking Yggdrasil. He could have had a plummet, but I'm looking at his stock cards, so I know he didn't draw it, and he clearly didn't have it before. He just killed Oshutai, most likely, the turn Macrux. So yeah, there's that. Yeah, he's Sexus Fetchling now, and I believe he's gonna play a big Hydra here. I still haven't hit a land, which is kind of annoying. I mean, I think I could have chosen to get lands off of Oshutai, but I chose to get more counter spells, which at some point I kind of regret, but yeah, the worst thing that can happen to me here is a Crux of, sorry, Hydra into Atarka. And but even if that happens, I have a Dragonlord Oshutai in my hand. So if I draw a land, I can counter the Hydra and steal the Atarka. Or even just, not counter the Hydra and steal the Atarka if it comes to that, but yeah. So here's another point where Fennell takes an absurdly long amount of time. And I think, honestly, I think something should have been done about it. Obviously, this is not a timed match, so it doesn't matter. But I still think someone should have said something. Because you're still required to play at a reasonable pace, and he most definitely is not. But yeah, here he just plays something, and, I counter it. And then I attack again and get to impulse again, or anticipate again. So I finally hit a sixth land, I think, or maybe a dig through time, or maybe both. Yeah, in case you, if you're watching this and thinking, wait, it didn't take long at all, that's because I've been pausing the video and letting it continue, which is why I know he took a long time, because I had to pause for like 2 minutes before he did anything. So anyway, I hit my sixth land, so which gives me the Dragon Lord, Silengar kind of insurance. And I know it has another Whisper, but I don't really care about that. So yeah, he finally plays his big Genesis Hydra. And does not hit Atarka, which will kill my dragon. So this board probably settles for a Planeswalker. But I still have Crux and Counterspell in my hand, I believe. Okay, so I see his top card. It's a forest, which it's worse for me because now I don't know what the top card is. I wanted to see the top card before I make my decision to counter the Hydra or not. But it doesn't really matter. So I get to see it's now it's a cursor. He attacks for 4, and now my plan is either I can Dragonlord Silmungar and steal one of his things, or I can just Crux and Counterspell up. So I'm gonna play a dig to ensure that I hit my seventh land drop so that I can go Counterspell Crux. I actually miss on the dig. I know I don't hit any untapped lands, but I do hit a Hero's Downfall. I knew it was there, I think. I scryed it on top of the temple. But I do hit a Hero's Downfall, which means I can downfall the Xenagus, and then I attack him instead of Xenagus to try to find my land for that Counterspell. And at this point, finding a Thoughtseize also works because I know the top card. But unfortunately, I don't find either untapped land or Thoughtseize. Yeah, so I kill the Xenagus, then on my turn, I attack him. So I find my land, and I think here, so I'm considering, do I want to Dragonlord him? Or do I want to Crux and counter him? And I think I make a mistake here. My assumption was, I'm gonna Dragonlord him. I know he doesn't have anything. So if he bricks on the land on top of Hydaibari, he dies. I know his card is Whisperwood, I think, because I saw him draw it from Corsair. But the problem with this play is that if he hits a land, he stays at 1 life, then he's gonna manifest a card. And that could be an Atarka, but even then he's gonna be low. Yeah, I think this play is actually fine now. And like at the time I regretted doing it because I thought, oh, what if this is Atarka, is this manifest on Atarka or something? But I don't think he's gonna win anyway. I am at a very low life total, so So maybe he would, actually. Yeah. Maybe I should not have let this happen. I should have just attacked in crooks and then countered his whisper wood, I think, as the play that I should have made. Yeah, this way, he's now at 9, and I can only attack him for 8. But it doesn't matter because his top card is not a Tarka. So I just know that this is what he's gonna, this is what he's gonna manifest, and next turn I can counter anything. I also know what it is next turn. So yeah, he manifests, it's a land. So now I know that I can just attack him and I don't bound the swing back, so I can't lose the game anymore. So yeah, the game ends here. Hi everyone, this is Paulo, and today I'm gonna go over my finals match against Chris Fennell at the TCGPlayer Invitational. The matchup is Esper Dragons against Red Green Devotion, which is a matchup that you're very likely to see if you play either of those two decks because they're both very common. And I think it was a very interesting match, so I want to go over what I did and why I did the things I did. So the first match begins, first game, pretty uneventfully. We both have a Temples, and then I play a Thoughtseize. When I Thoughtseize him, I see Deathmask Raptor, Xenagos, two Whisper of Elementals, and three lands. So at this point, I think Xenagos is the clear choice because I don't want to risk him drawing a 2-drop and then playing a turn 3 Xenagos, which is one of the ways I could lose this game. Raptor is not really much of a threat because it doesn't block dragons and doesn't kill me fast enough. So, and I have Overtime in my hand already, so I'm pretty sure I can race his Raptor, so I don't care about it. So yeah, I take Xenagos. The game progresses to a point where he plays his Raptor, he hasn't drawn anything yet. Next turn he attacks, I take the damage because I don't want to spend Hero's Downfall killing a Raptor. And then he plays an Elvish Mystic. Now at this point, I actually consider playing the Hero's Downfall on his Raptor at the end of the turn because I want a clear board when I play my Ujutai. But I figured that I can still race anything he plays, and I can Hero's Downfall the Whisperwood and find an answer for a second Whisperwood. So now I know the game is going to be, we're going to be at a point where I'm just going to play my Ujutai, he's going to attack for 3, play Whisperwood, manifest, I'm going to kill Whisperwood, and then I'll be at 12 life because I have a fetch land. So, but with a dragon. So I think that's a pretty good position for me to be in. So I don't want to Hero's Downfall of the Raptor because. So the game progresses to a point where this is exactly what I was expecting. I attack with my Ujutai, and then I hit 3 lands. But it's important here that one of the lands is a temple, one of the lands is a Dismal Backwater. So most of the time we're going to take the temple there. But Dismal Backwater is actually better in this spot because I'm at exactly 12 life. And the way this game is going to go is I'm going to kill his elemental and counter his next elemental, which will leave him with 6 power in play. So if I'm at 13 life, that gives me a whole extra turn because his deck has no way of doing direct damage. So Dismal Backwater in this spot is much, much better than Temple of Deceit. So it's very important to recognize this, to be able to see, well, he has 6 damage, I'm at 12, so that's theoretically 2 turns, but with one more life, I gain one extra turn. At this point, his game is very academic. He is not racing me, and he's definitely not overwhelming me with threats because I'm drawing 2 cards a turn, and I have a dig 3 time. So he attacks for 6. Yeah, and then I think I can just fast forward here because this is basically me reacting to everything he does and him dying to my Ujutai. So here for game 2, I keep what I think is a pretty bad hand, and perhaps I shouldn't have kept. The hand was Disdainful Stroke, dig 3 time, and 5 lands, among which 2 or 3 temples, but no blue-black temple. So my reasoning was that I had one answer for his cards, and Disdainful Stroke is one of my best cards on the draw because it's one of the few ways that I can deal with a turn 3 Xenagos. And I also had a fetch land, and I thought I would just have time to cast my dig, and that proved to be incorrect. Here you can see that I draw, and on my first turn I had the choice between playing a Temple or a Dismal Backwater, but I played Dismal Backwater, even though I drew a land, so I actually really want spells. I think the chance that I might draw Bioblade on turn 2 to kill his mana guy is just more important than playing the Temple and Scrying 1, because Scry is going to be good no matter what. So I think giving me the chance to Bioblade that guy is more important than, because I have this Disdainful Stroke, so I'm not looking for any specific card on turn 2 other than Bioblade itself that I can't even cast if I play the temple. So in this spot it's just better to do that. Here, I disdain to stroke his Zenigus, which, prompts a comment from him that I either don't have Scorn or I have Scorn plus Dragon, which is true. Like, if I had only Scorn and no Dragon, I would have cast Scorn, and so I either have neither or both. Sorry, I could have a dragon, but if I have Scorn, I definitely have a dragon to go with it. So there's not much point in trying to play around the Force Spike effect because I very likely don't have one. I have to top deck one. At this point, you can see I'm just playing temples and putting cards on the bottom, but my hand is still five lands in and a dig three time. So I'm in a pretty bad spot here. So yeah, while I'm thinking here, well, Fennell's thinking because he took a very long time this match. But yeah, so this is the reasoning. This is the moment he made his comment about not playing around Force Spike, and it was correct to do so because he could have waited to play that Zenigus, but that wouldn't have done much. He can't play around at that point. So yeah, since I'm pretty bad this game, this is a Crux of Fate, but it doesn't actually help me much this time. So I don't want to cast that. I just want to pass the turn. I hope he commits something more to it, but I'm pretty low already, so I'm probably not winning this game. Anyway, I think one thing I forgot to mention in the past game is that I already had the counter spell on my hand when I played my Urshifu, and a lot of people would have just passed the turn and tried to control the game. Let's pause here. I died. Okay, a lot of people would just try to control the game, get counter one, or do Esper, downfall the other, and then play the Urshifu. I think this is not the correct approach. You said I just tapped out turn 5 to play Urshifu and let him resolve Whisper that I knew he had. Because Urshifu just beats everything. So, if I have an answer to the Whisperwood, I don't care if he manifests something. Whisperwood is going to draw answers to that. So, I think this is a very important point that you have to keep in mind when you play this Esper deck. Is that it is not that much that reactive of a deck. It is a reactive deck, it is a control deck. But you can kill people, and you should. And Urshifu is just, Urshifu is the best card in play almost every time he's in play. And he's going to beat anything they throw at you. So, most of the time, I just want to jam a turn 5 Urshifu if I can. So, game 3 starts a bit slowly. I sprout card to the bottom. And then I think a key point here is turn 2. So, turn 2, my hand is I have a Heroes Downfall, a Polluted Delta, and a Caves of Scoreless. So, I don't have a counter spell that I want to cast. So, I have no incentive to play a Delta and bluff blue mana unless I specifically. Sorry. Play up Delta and have blue mana, unless I want to bluff a counter spell. But if I do that, then the only way for me to cast my Hero's Downfall on turn 3 is by sacking that Delta for Swamp, which could be very bad. And it is what ends up happening. So you see, I think playing the Caves of Scoreless here, the commentator has actually remarked on that, is very important. Because I want to be able to Hero's Downfall on turn 3, but I don't want to have to sack my Delta for black mana. So now I draw Swamp. So that gives me the option of playing Downfall on turn 3 and still keeping a second source of blue mana in my hand. Which I think is very, very important. You have to pay attention to those details. You have to plan ahead and think, oh, how's this my turn 3 gonna go, my turn 4 gonna go? So he plays a Courser. That resolves. It is annoying, but obviously I can't stop it. And I decide not to downfall it because my hand has two Crux of Fates. So if my hand was a bunch of spot removal, I would have just killed it. But since I have two Cruxes, I feel like I'm just gonna get. He's probably just going to play a Genesis Hydra or something now, and I'm going to Crux everything away. So I let him draw an extra card effectively by having his Forest, and now I can Heroes Downfall the Whisperwood that he can play and clear the board. Now, this is a pretty interesting situation because he's going to play a Whisperwood here. So my options are I can Downfall it before or after he manifests. So why would I Downfall it after he manifests? Because his top card is a Xenagos. So the question is, do I want him drawing a Xenagos? And I decided that no, I don't. Now, let's pause here for a second. So, no, I don't want him to draw the Xenagus because at this point, if I downfall the Whisperwood, I can actually just play a Nozhutai. So, eventually, I'm going to attack him instead of Xenagus with the Nozhutai, and that's going to be another card that I draw, another good card. So, I think this is a pretty close decision. It's made particularly close by the fact that I don't know that he has red mana if I Crux away that Caryatid. So he could have a mountain in his hand or a Wood of Foothills. It makes sense that he would not have played a Wood of Foothills yet because it has Force in play and his top has been good every time. So my plan here is, I'm gonna kill the Esper. The question is, do I want him to have this news or not? And I decide that I don't. So after thinking for a while, I let him manifest. I see his next top card, and then I can kill the Whisperwood and play my Urshifu if I want to. So here, this is already an extreme. I've let him manifest and downfall the Whisperwood. I actually make a mistake here because at the end of the turn, I thought I was just gonna sacrifice my Delta for an island. So I took 1 damage from Kiss of Coast to cast Hero's Downfall, which would be okay, except I already had another Delta in my hand that I knew I was gonna probably get swamped with. So I should have just gotten the swamp at the end of the turn and not taking one extra damage. But yeah, now I can play Ojutai and just stop the bleeding, and I know that I have Crux of Fate in my hand still. So there's not much that he can do that is threatening to me because a Planeswalker I can just attack. So Whisperwood will be the worst card because he manifests something else, and if I Crux everything away, he gets two more manifests, but it's still not that big a deal. So I feel like even though, it might look like I'm in a bad spot, I really don't think I am. I really like this spot I'm in this game at this point. Every time you have an Urshifu in play and a Crux of Fate in your hand against Red Green Devotion, it is very hard to lose unless you play Whisperwood. So yeah, I know he has Genesis Hydra in hand. So the worst that can happen is he goes Genesis Hydra into Whisperwood, which will leave him with 3 manifests in play. But I have 2 Cruxes. So even then, even if that happens, that is the worst possible, I can just Crux out everything, attack him for 5, draw a card, and then take 6 damage, and next turn Crux everything away again. Oh, I'm sorry, he only had access to 6 mana, so he couldn't even Genesis Hydra for 5 there. But it doesn't matter, he could have just played another Whisperwood. So it would have been fine. Here in this spot, he thinks for a very long time. I think actually I should have gotten a warning here. But he's thinking, like, do I want to make a token and throw my Courser away to deal 4 damage to you in case you have Crux of Fate? Because clearly, if I don't have Crux of Fate, he doesn't want to attack. Right? Because throwing away his Courser for 4 damage is not worth it. But if I do have Crux of Fate, he wants to attack. But the problem is, perhaps by attacking, he makes it so that I don't even need Crux. I can just play, attack his and goes and play 2 removal spells or whatever, and then the board's clear anyway. So I think in the end, he decides not to attack, which I think is the correct decision. I think the 4 damage is unlikely to matter if I do have Crux, or if I don't have Crux. So just force me to have it, and if I have it, whatever, you miss 4 damage, that's probably not gonna matter. So correct decision by him. He took a very long time on it though. Yeah, so I attack, kill Xenagos, and play Crux of Fate. So at this point, it's looking very, very hard for me to lose the game. I don't have a land. I couldn't attack him because I wanted to kill Xenagos, but it's still not a big deal. Like, I know he has Plummet in his deck, but I have another Ojutai in my hand, I think. And I have counter spells. So if I untap this time, it's probably game over. Yeah, I do have another extra time in my hand. So yeah, this is the kind of game that you're probably not gonna lose. Here he has to think. He has a morph that he can play. He has to think, do I want to get rid of this Nissa, which is a great card, so that I can play this morph? Because I don't have Verbwork in play, so he has to stack that Fetchland to play the morph. And then he decides to do that. So he searches his library for a mountain, and then plays his morph. So I look at his graveyard, it could be Dim Protector. I know they only have one. It could be a Raptor, it could be a Mist, it could be a Dim Protector, but I think it's still worth it to just kill it. Especially because I can kill it and keep Counterspell mana up. So it's not really a big deal. And I think I have multiple Counterspells at this point. Yeah, I think I have at least 2. So nothing bad is going to happen. Yeah, it was a mistake, but that's not bad either. It just also shrinks his Genesis Hydra that I know he has. Like the mystic at 2 mana. So I want to Bioblade it regardless of what it is. Unless it's exactly Raptor. But I think it's worth Bioblading it. Yeah, here for now is probably thinking whether he wants to draw that Whisperwood or not. He plays a Morph again. And normally I wouldn't counter Dismorph, but I have two counter spells and only two blue mana. So the thing that's constraining me in this game is mana and not cards. So with four open mana, there's not much that he can do that is threatening. Like Xenagos is probably his best four mana card, but he would have played that pre-combat if he had it. So at this point, I think I just don't wanna let him have more pressure on me. So it was a bonus that I killed the Dim Protector. What would I counter almost anything in that spot that didn't leave him with 5 mana up? Because again, I have more counter spells in my hand, and I can only cast one a turn anyway. So the best way for me to lose this game, not best way, but the most likely way, is if I just get a bunch of answers in my hand and I have time to cast them. Not if I run out of answers, especially if I'm attacking Yggdrasil. He could have had a plummet, but I'm looking at his stock cards, so I know he didn't draw it. And he clearly didn't have it before. He just killed Oshutai, most likely, the turn Nykrux. So yeah, there's that. Yeah, he's Sexus Fetchling now. And I believe he's gonna play a big Hydra. I still haven't hit a land, which is kind of annoying. I mean, I think I could have chosen to get lands off of Oshutai, but I chose to get more counter spells, which at some point I kind of regret, but. Yeah, the worst thing that can happen to me here is a Crux of, sorry, Hydra into Atarka. And but even if that happens, I have a Dragonlord Ojutai in my hand. So if I draw a land, I can counter the Hydra and steal the Atarka. Or even just, not counter the Hydra and steal the Atarka if it comes to that. But yeah. So here's another point where Fennell takes an absurdly long amount of time. And I think, honestly, I think something should have been done about it. Obviously, this is not a timed match, so it doesn't matter. But I still think someone should have said something. Because you're still required to play at a reasonable pace, and he most definitely is not. But yeah, here he just plays something, and, I counter it. And then I attack again, and get to impulse again, or anticipate again. So I finally hit a 6th land, I think. Or maybe a dig through time. Or maybe both. Yeah, in case if you're watching this and thinking, wait, it didn't take long at all, that's because I've been pausing the video and letting it continue, which is why I know he took a long time, because I had to pause for like 2 minutes before he did anything. So anyway, I hit my 6th land, so which gives me the Dragon Lord Silengar kind of insurance. And I know he has another Whisper, but I don't really care about that. So yeah, he finally plays his big Genesis Hydra. And does not hit Atarka, which will kill my dragon. So this board probably settles for a Planeswalker. But I still have Crux and Counterspell in my hand, I believe. Okay, so I see his top card. It's a forest, which it's worse for me because now I don't know what the top card is. I wanted to see the top card before I make a decision to counter the Hydra or not, but it doesn't really matter. So I get to see it's now it's a cursor. He attacks for 4, and now my plan is either I can Dragonlord Silmungar and steal one of his things, or I can just Crux and counterspell up. So I'm gonna play a dig to ensure that I hit my 7th land drop so that I can go counterspell Crux. I actually miss on the dig. I know I don't hit any untapped lands, but I do hit a Hero's Downfall. I knew it was there, I think. I scryed it on top of the temple. But I do hit a Hero's Downfall, which means I can downfall the Xenagos, and then I attack him instead of Xenagos to try to find my land for the counterspell. And at this point, finding a Thoughtseize also works because I know the top card. But unfortunately, I don't find either untapped land or Thoughtseize. Yeah, so I kill the Xenagos. Then on my turn, I attack him. So I find my land. And I think here, so I'm considering, do I want to Dragon Lord him, or do I want to Crux and counter him? And I think I make a mistake here. My assumption was, I'm gonna Dragon Lord him. I know he doesn't have anything. So if he bricks on the land on top of the library, he dies. I know his card is Whisperwood, I think, because I saw him draw it from Courser. But the problem with this play is that if he hits a land, he stays at one life, then he's gonna manifest a card. And that could be an Atharka, but even then he's gonna be low. Yeah, I think this play is actually fine now. And like at the time I regretted doing it because I thought, oh, what if this is Atharka, is this manifest on Atharka or something? But I don't think he's gonna win anyway. I am at a very low life total, so maybe he would, actually. Yeah, maybe I should not have let this happen. I should have just attacked in Crux and then countered his Whisperwood, I think, as the play that I should have made. Yeah, this way, he's now at 9, and I can only attack him for 8. But it doesn't matter because his top card is not Atharka. So I just know that this is what he's gonna. This is why he's going to manifest, and next turn I can counter anything. I also know what it is next turn. So yeah, he manifests, it's a land. So now I know that I can just attack him, and I don't die on the swing back, so I can't lose the game anymore. So yeah, the game ends here. Alright, so this is game 4. Fennell is with a Rotoclaw Mystic. Which is not a big deal because I have Silengar supporting my hand, so I can counter whatever he plays next. And his play is a Deathmist Raptor, which normally I wouldn't counter because my hand, I have Silengar Scorn and Ojutai in my hand. So I don't have to run the Forest Pike as early as I can, and Deathmist Raptor is not a particularly threatening card. But I feel like I should counter it this game because I have Ash Shock in my hand that I want to play on turn 3. So if I don't counter it, I just let him attack Ash Shock for 5 and kill it for free, and that's really bad for me. So this way I guarantee that even if he spends his next turn attacking it, it will be at least 3 loyalty, which already gets me a Courser, for example, which is a fantastic card. It's very hard to lose when you get a Courser with the Esper deck. Like, if Courser wasn't the Esper colors, this deck would just be invincible. So I play that shock. I only hit Elvish Mystic, which is fine, but not what I was hoping for. But in this specific case, it's fine because I have Dragon Lord Silengar in my hand. So or I will draw that next turn. I'm not really sure, but so I can just put an offense into play and accelerate that for one turn by one turn. Okay, so here he plays his Whisperwood, which I'm gonna steal when I get to 6 mana, which would be in 2 turns. So it's gonna manifest twice, which is an issue, but hopefully, I can brick the manifests with my 3/5 Death Touch. And here's an interesting spot. I have a temple. Here, let me pause this for a second. I have a temple in my hand, and I want to cast Anticipate. So normally, what you want to do here is you want to cast Anticipate first. And then play a temple. Because you don't want to dilute the card you scry into the same three cards you anticipate. So, for example, say I scry into a good card, I want to keep it. Then, when I anticipate, I already know which card I want. So, I'm just basically drawing a card and putting the top two in the bottom. However, if I anticipate first, then I can get the same card, and then I can play the temple and filter for my next draw. So normally, unless you're looking for a card this specific turn, which I'm not because I don't have any more mana, what you want to do is you want to anticipate and then play the temple. This time, however, I don't do that because I think having my mana open and A, threatening a counter spell or even a removal spell of some sort, and B, letting him play the game so I can see what's happening, so I can see what I want to anticipate into, is worth more than that one scry. Yeah, so it's more than one scry that I'll get. So at this point, if I tempo into a card that is very good, I can just not play the anticipate, or even just play it to cycle, whatever, it's not a big deal. I ended up temploing to something bad, so I put it at the bottom, which was good. But yeah, so this is like a deviation from the norm because I just wanted to keep my mana open and wanted to see what he would do before I had to anticipate. So here Fennell attacks my Ashiok. He's considering whether he wants to attack it with both or just the elemental, but if he attacks with only the elemental, I can chump block. He ends up attacking with both, I just let it die. I was gonna let it die regardless because I need the elf to play the Dragonlord Cylinder. Of course, he didn't know that. But yeah, there's no point in keeping it alive there. I need that elf right now. Now he plays a Courser, which resolves and reveals a Plummet, which luckily for me is gonna get manifested. So I'll not have to deal with it on my Dragonlord Silungar. So yeah, situation is actually looking not that bad for me, unless it has Dragonlord Darkrai to kill my Dragonlord Silungar, because Silungar is a 3/5 death touch guy, so he just brick walls everything. He cannot attack me, and my hand's very good. I think I have Ojutai and two digs, so all that I need to do is survive for a little bit. And then hopefully I can take control of the game. He does have a raptor in his graveyard. And two manifests, one of which I know is Plummet, one I don't know. But I can assume slash hope that it's just a land at that point, or not a creature. But yeah, so I just, tap, play my Dragonlord. And Fennell sacrifices Whisper Blade, of course, because if he lets me steal, I can just sacrifice it myself, even if he kills my Dragonlord. So there's no reason to ever let me get it. Though this did happen in a GP once. My opponent let me get it, I manifested, and then he killed the elemental, the dragon, and I just sacrificed the elemental, manifested again, and he didn't get anything. But yeah, here he plays Dragonlord Atarka, which is quite bad for me. And then he smashes for 6, bringing me down to 12. So at this point, I have to find, basically, assuming he has anything else, I have to find a spot removal, which has to be Downfall when it comes to Atarka, and Crux of Fate, or two Crux of Fates. Either of those will kind of work and get me out of this spot. So here I know I'm casting Dig through time, and the question is, do I want to dig for 2 mana or for 3 mana? Since I'm trying to find, I'm trying to find Hero's Downfall anyway. I figure I might as well dig for 3 mana and keep that Dragonlord Silungar in my graveyard, because that's the best card to return with Haven. So I don't have a Haven yet, but it's a long-term plan, and that 1 mana is not going to do anything for me. So I dig, I keep black-black one open, I have that elf. So, and my hope is that I'll find Hero's Downfall and Crux for the follow-up. I do find the Downfall, but I don't find the Crux. So I play my land and pass. It's a temple. On his turn, Fennell attacks with everybody. Or rather, he sacks a fetchland, shuffles his Mystic away, and then attacks, then plays a Genesis Hydra. Which I actually think was kind of a mistake here, because I need Crux to leave anyway. He could have just played his Relicall Mystic, and if I didn't do anything, he would unmorph it and bring back the raptor, and that would be enough damage to lethal me if I don't have Crux. So he doesn't need this Hydra, and now he got rid of two Hydras, the one that was in his hand and one that was on top of his library. So if he just plays a Mystic and passes, then even if I Crux, I have to have answer for two of his Hydras on next turn. So I think that was a mistake by him. But here, so he attacks with everybody, and I know that to win the game, I have to find Crux. So I end up not blocking with my elf. Why don't I block with my elf? Because I could draw Anticipate. Now there is one Anticipate left in my deck at this point. So if I block the Mystic with, so the Red Claw Mystic with the Elvish Mystic, I take two less damage. But in the grand scheme of things, this two damage doesn't matter. I have to find Crux or I'll lose. So if I'm banking on finding Crux, I might as well give myself the biggest chance of finding Crux possible, which is to have 7 mana available so that I can draw Anticipate and Anticipating Crux. It's not likely, but I felt, especially considering there's only one Anticipate left in my deck, but I felt like it was more important than the 2 damage was going to be. So I end up at 3 life, and I don't draw Crux, so that's the game. Okay, so here it's game 5, and I lead with a Caves of Colossus and a Thoughtseize. In some matchups, I think it's possible that you just play a tap land on turn 1, so on turn 2 you can Thoughtseize because you get more information, and maybe Imagined his hand, but there's no Xenos. Xenos is on top of his library. So I really want to toss to Xenos turn 2 as opposed to turn 1. And in this case, I know I'm not doing anything on turn 2. But I still prefer to take a point of damage and toss to Xenos first because I could just take Elvish Mystic. So the way my hand is constructed is I want to play Ash Trap on turn 3 to want to stall him as much as possible. So if I can't take Elvish Mystic, I'll do that. But he doesn't have it. And I would rather take the Xenos. So that, it's conceivable that you would take Sylvan character here, I think. But he has a lot of mana sirens. So if I just take the character and he draws another one, that's so bad for me. So I just take the Xenagos, which kind of assures that unless stop attacks exactly another Xenagos, I will get to Aatrox something good. Here I think I get a bit unlucky because I hit absolutely nothing when basically any creature in his deck would have worked. So that was a bit of a bummer. He plays a raptor, which is not that big a deal, I don't think. Yeah, at this point, he just sacks his fetch, and I'm like, oh my god, he drew Xenagos again. And I'm thinking, this is the only way I can lose this game because my whole setup is good. I don't have a fourth land here, which could be an issue. I also don't have double blue, but Aatrox, unopposed, is very powerful against this Red Wing deck because they have a lot of trouble answering their own creatures. Like, they can't beat the Whisperwood. They can't beat an Autarka. They can't beat, like, a Hornet Queen. So, even Courser is very hard for them to beat out of the Esper deck. So, here I draw. It's not a land. I do have a Bow Blight. But, yeah, I don't have another land. So, I pass the turn, and here my plan is that I will not kill his to Deathmist Raptor when he attacks. I also have Old Way Price in my hand, I believe. So I don't want to risk. Even if I didn't, though. I don't want to risk, I kill his Raptor when he's attack phase, and then he just plays a Morph and brings Raptor back. That would be so bad for me. To hear the Raptor is not threatening much, because Aatrox is still going to be at 4, so I can still bring the Courser, and I can still, keep Aatrox alive by doing that. So I don't want him to go Morph here, or even like a Whisperwood. At this point, I don't remember. I can't see if I have a hard removal spell for Whisperwood. But yeah, I would rather just kill it at the end of the turn and have my Aatrox lose 3 life. 3 loyalty, that is. Here, I get pretty lucky. I hit a Polluted Delta off of my Courser. And at this point, with him passing the turn on 6 mana, I think I can't lose the game. This game looks very, very favorable for me in this spot. Because the only way I was thinking I could lose this game was if I didn't draw lands, but I just drew two in the same turn, one for my draw phase and one for a Courser. So that venue, I'm not gonna lose because of that anymore. At least it's not likely. Yeah, here he was a Genesis Hydra for 4, hits his own Courser. So the way this goes, this Courser goes into play. And I get to see the top card of his library before I decide what to do with Genesis Hydra. Because I can counter Courser, but I can't counter the Hydra. And normally, I wouldn't care much about the Hydra, but I don't have a dragon in my hand. So my Sylvengar Scorn is effectively a force spike. So at this point, he does have only 6 mana. So his 7 drops, which are the trouble, like the bigger. His 7 drops are his best cards at this point. Yeah, I can force pipeline next turn, but not this turn after that. So the options are I could counter the Genesis Hydra and ultimate price the Courser, or simply ultimate price the Genesis Hydra and leave the Courser there, and hope to force pipe something next turn. But he also has a Mystic on top of his library. Oh, the Mystic's gonna be gone with the Aatrox anyway. But yeah. So yeah, at this point I have to decide, do I want to force back something next turn, maybe? Or do I want to just get a board clear now? I decide that it's better to clear the board. Because I have two digs in my hand, and I have removal, so even if he does resolve Autarka, it's not that huge a deal, and he could just resolve it next turn. Though of course that would give me one turn to dig for Nessie, so I think it was actually a close play. He had few cards in hand. I didn't even know if he had a seventh land, so I thought getting rid of the Courser, was good, and I thought I had to get rid of the Genesis Hydra because it was a 4-4, and he gets past my Courser to kill my Aatrox. So I don't know if this was a good decision or not, but the line I chose was counter the Hydra and kill the Courser to leave an empty board. So on my turn, I plus Ashiok, so now I don't know his top card anymore. And I don't attack with my courser because I don't want him to draw Z-negatives and heat my Ashiok. So I think the 2 damage here is fairly irrelevant at this point because I generally do damage in chunks of 5 anyway, and he's at 18. So there's no reason for me to attack with courser here. Like, he could just draw Z-negatives, make a surgery, attack my Ashiok for free, and I don't want that to happen. So here I play on. I have a temple, but I decided not to play it because, I like that the hero's downfall is there anyway. Yeah, so I pass the turn. Fennell plays an Atarka. On his turn, 7 land Atarka, which resolves. He kills my courser and deals 1 damage to my Ashiok. So here, I can cast a dig on his turn. And again, I feel like I'm a massive favorite. Something has to be really wrong for me to lose here. So on my turn, I play a temple, I think for a bit, I keep my card, and I bring an elf into play with Ashiok. And then I pass the turn. And my hand is another dig, the downfall that I took, and some other stuff. Like a Bioblide. Yeah, so here Fennell attacks my Ashiok. And the commentators are expecting me to downfall the Ashiok. And so is Fennell, I think, because everyone knows that I have downfall. I reveal it for a courser. And I supposedly took it with the dig. But I don't do that. Why don't I do that? Because I don't have a counter spell in my hand, and I'm worried about the second Atarka that he could have. I think at this point, there are not that many heroes downfalls in my deck. So if, let's say I just downfall the Atarka, I don't have a way to deal with his second Atarka if he plays that, so he kills my elf and has an 8-8. And there are not that many ways in my deck to deal with it. So I think Ashiok is not that relevant, and I just want to dig and try to find either any sort of counter spell. Or a Thoughtseize. So, but I brick completely, which is ends up being very bad for me. So my plan here was I'll let Ashiok die, I'll dig, then on my turn I'll deal with Atarka and either counter or discard his potential next Atarka. Because this card in his hand has been in his hand for a while, so I think it could be a 7-drop, or it could also be a Plummet. And I don't want to expose myself to another Atarka, is basically it. And honestly, I think that play was correct. I think if, I have a lot more outs, if I'm digging for Thoughtseize or Disdainful Stroke or Dissolve or Silungar Scorn or Heroes Downfall or Crux, as opposed to I'm digging for exactly Heroes Downfall and Crux. Here I can anticipate main phase. There's nothing to, because I want to know if I draw a Silungar Scorn or a Disdainful Stroke or a Thoughtseize, I'm gonna kill that Atarka. But I did not. So I'm just gonna be in the exact same spot next turn. So if I downfall the Atarka now, he could just play another one, and that's gonna be very bad for me. So what do I think? I think I can just afford to take 8 damage here, and then I'll kill Atarka next turn. And that will give me even more time to draw an answer to a potential second Atarka. And I'm at 17. And my life photo, I think, is a resource that I can use. So I think it's okay to take 8. Here, I think Fennell attacked way too quickly with this Atarka. Let me pause the video here. Because normally, I think it would actually be. Well, actually, he knew I had a hero's downfall. So it wouldn't. Yeah, it wouldn't. He would have attacked regardless, I think. So let me unpause. Yeah. So I'm not gonna block, obviously. I take 8, I go down to 9, and he passes the turn. So what is discarding his hand? What do I think? I think it's a Plummet at this point. Either a Plummet or an Atarka. Because those are the cards that he couldn't have played. So how do I play thinking that it's a Plummet? I decided or Plummet or an Atarka. My decision was to not attack with Ojutai. Because I've been playing the whole game trying to beat Atarka, which is the best card that could be in his hand. And if I just attack with Ojutai now and he does have Atarka, that seems kind of awkward. And again, Plummet. So I don't know if I should have attacked or not. I think if this card is Atarka, I actually should attack because I can hit Thoughtseize and his Disdainful Stroke. But if this card is Plummet, then I don't want to attack because I want to maybe draw into a counter spell. Here, I think I make a mistake. If I'm not wrong, I have a dig through time in my hand, and I have enough mana to cast Downfall, and then cast Dig. And maybe he'd land plus Thoughtseize, which would have been good. But I decided to just play Ashok and pass instead, and now I have to Downfall because I don't want to go to 2 life. But yeah, I think the way I played was okay. As it turned out, he did have the plummet in his hand. So if I had attack, he would just have killed it. And this was, yeah, this. I didn't want to expose my Ojutai to a second Atarka here. Because, you know, this is the moment for him to play the second Atarka if he has it. And yeah, he does have it. So he plays the Atarka, kills my Ashok, which is fine, and it makes me feel like a genius for not attacking, but maybe I should have attacked and tried to draw a counter spell, but again, he had a plummet. So whatever. Yeah, so here I draw another dig, I think. So yeah, I think this was a bit confusing the way I explained all this, but the key point here is that what do I fear? How am I losing this game? And the answer is I'm losing to an unresolved Atarka. There are not many other cards that will beat me in this spot I'm in, but Atarka is the hardest card in his deck for me to deal with because, you know, if I'm gonna crux it away, I'll have to kill my own dragon in the middle of it. I can't attack through it. I can't ultimate price it. So the only thing left is Hero's Downfall. And I don't have that many of those. So what was I thinking? I don't wanna kill his Atarka before I have a way to answer a second one. So I was gonna dig and play Anticipate. And I had to hope to find a discard spell or a counter spell. I think that's, you know, like roughly 10 cards in my deck, roughly a sixth of my deck. More because I haven't seen many of them in this game yet. So say like a fifth or even a fourth of my deck, and I'm looking at 10 cards. So I think I was very likely to find one, which is why I made the play I made. I didn't really care much about my life total, because being a 9 or being at 17 doesn't make much of a difference against a red-green deck. They're not an aggressive deck, they're not gonna burn me out. So if they kill me, it would be by attacking with, you know, a bunch of 4/4 tramplers, or a bunch of manifest guys, or, you know, gigantic hydras and atarkas and hornet queens. So I thought that it was worth taking the damage to maybe set myself up for the rest of a second attack. I think in this part I played very well, and I would have done the same thing again. The part that maybe I could have done differently was attacking the Dragon Lord Ojutai in the hopes of drawing an answer for his second attack. But then if I don't draw an answer, Atarka is just gonna kill Ojutai because it's gonna be tapped. So that would have been pretty awkward. And I also thought he could have Plummet in hand, because that was a card that he hadn't played for the entire game, and Plummet was basically the only card other than second Atarka that he had the opportunity to he didn't have the opportunity to play. So I decided not to attack, hoping to draw into a counterspell or a Thoughtseize, of which there were many left in my deck. So I think that was a reasonable line. It probably cost me the game, but I still think it was reasonable. Yeah, so here I dig again, and I have to find a answer for that Atarka. And I hope it's not Crux of Fate, because, you know. I have to kill my Ojutai. But here is another. I dig again. And again, I have the opportunity to find any Thoughtseize, or any Silengar Scorn, or Dissolve. And I break again. So I think, in this point, I do hit Hero's Downfall, which is lucky. There are not that many left in my deck. I think there are. Actually, there are maybe 3 left in my deck, so it's not that lucky, but there might be 2. But yeah, not hitting a counterspell or a Thoughtseize there was a massive stroke of bad luck. I think if I hit either of those cards, I basically win the game on the spot. So now I think his card is Plummet. I know he has 2 mana. I can't. One of my options is killing his elf and attacking with Ojutai. And perhaps I should have done that. At the time, sorry, let me pause the video again. At the time, I didn't worry much about it because I had this Dingfo stroke. So I didn't want to tap out and have him play a Nissa or a Whisperwind on me. So, and I had the Haven, so I wanted to draw the Plummet out of his hand, so next turn I could Haven back a dragon or even draw play another dragon. Yeah, I didn't have another one in my hand, but yeah, so I couldn't Bioblight the Elf, but I could have
played Dealt my price on the elf. I have enough black for that. I had three black. Open my price the elf and attack a Vojutai and guarantee a hit. But at that point, I'm tapped out. If I didn't have this Daneful Stroke in my hand, I might have done that. But since I did have Stroke, I thought I was safe from any of his top decks, so it wasn't that big a deal. What I wasn't safe from, of course, is a Genesis Hydra that he ended up drawing, which ended up hitting the best card I think that he could have hit, which was a Nissa. So if he just draws Nissa, I probably win the game because I have this Daneful Stroke. But he drew Hydra into Nissa, so I couldn't counter the Nissa, and that was very bad for me. Yeah, at this point, even if it's like a Whisperwood, I'm fine because I have the ultimate prize in my hand, but the Nissa is really a problem. So I think I end up just Disdainful Stroking the Hydra. And now I'm actually in trouble. Because I am at 4 life. If I had a dragon, I think I would have maybe been fine because I had a Bioblite too. But I don't have a dragon, so I think I just have to play an Ashiok here. And at this point, I know that if he animates anything that is not a forest, then I'm dead. Because he has 8 trampling damage, and I only have the elf plus Bioblite, which is 4, so that's already 4 damage to my face. So at this point, I need him to animate a forest. Luckily for me, I think the chance of him animating a forest there is very high, because he only has one mountain, and Nyxos is just a better land. So most people will naturally animate the forest unless they're specifically thinking of Bioblite. So okay, I have to assume that this is what he's gonna do, because if he doesn't do that, then I lose. So I just play Ashiok, and I mill a courser, which is actually good. And at this point, in a Hornet Queen, if the game gets to that point. So at this point, I'm thinking I could actually win. In fact, if I top deck something like, a Dragon Lord Silengar, I could win the game, because that just steals the Nissa. Unfortunately, he drew another Genesis Hydra. So yeah, here he animates forest again. Attacks me. I kill a forest by blocking with my elf and Bioblighting it. I can't afford to not block because I have to take one damage to Bioblight because I have a Caves of Carlos. So I need to tap that mana. And I need to block, otherwise I'm dead. So I go to one, and I kill one forest, each forest is one, or whatever. And at this point, I think if I draw Dragon Lord Silengar, I can just play the courser, play a land, go to two, steal Nissa, activate Nissa, and make my land a 4/4, which will leave me with three blockers, and him with only two attackers. So that would actually be a great position for me. Here I'm thinking what I want to do. Do I want to return my Dragon Lord Ojutai? And I decided, yes, I do, so I tap my Alpha or whatever. And here he plays, another Genesis Hydra, which is like, oh, so bad for me. But I can still win if he hits just a creature, because I could draw Crux, so that I can go Crux and animate get a courser to block his Nissa target. It will put me at a very bad spot, but I can win. But instead he hits Xenagos and makes a token, which means that even by drawing Dragonlord Silengar, I still don't have enough damage. So I do end up drawing Dragonlord Silengar, but at this point it's not enough. Yeah, it was the card I needed to draw. So if he hadn't drawn that Genesis Hydra, I'd probably have won the game. So yeah, that was it. In the end, I lost the finals, which was, very disappointing because I think it's a good matchup. I think I was way ahead this entire game, and I think I played very well. I think maybe I got punished a little bit by my choices, but I think my choices all made sense. Like when I'm looking back at this video, I'm very honest in what I believe. So if I thought I had made a mistake, I would not have any qualms about saying it. But yeah, so in the end, I ended up losing, but I really liked the way I played. And I thought those games were so interesting that and they offer so many different perspectives and so many little details that I think mattered, that I decided to do this video to explain why I did the things I did. Because, most people they kept asking me on Twitter, like, why didn't you downfall the Atarka earlier? Why didn't you Bioblite the Raptor that was gonna attack your Ashiok? And stuff like that. So hopefully this Even if you don't agree with me, hopefully I have explained to you why I did the things I did. So yeah, that's it. I hope you enjoy this kind of video. I do like doing them, so they take a little bit of work, but I wouldn't mind doing more if people did like them. And yeah. So and congrats to Fennell. Of course, he played very well. And yeah, congrats to me too. All right, see you next video.